Okay, thanks everybody for coming. My name's John Hoskins. I've been an advisor to our researchers, secondary advisor, as well as laboratory technician. We've had five students, interns, doing our presentation today for the winter internship 2017. TJ Kennedy, our primary advisor. And we'll be talking about alcohol dehydrogenase today and how we've progressed over the last couple years and continuing on. So I'll let the guys introduce themselves and we'll get going.
I'm Joseph Lee.
I'm Daniel Garcia.
I'm Brandon Marin.
I'm William Turner.
And I'm Nicholas Zavala.
All right, good evening, everybody.
Joseph, wait.
Sorry. You're fine.
So good evening, everybody. For the past 4 weeks, we've been working with an enzyme that primarily comes from yeast, and it's known as the S-tyrosinase. This enzyme is it's called alcohol dehydrogenase. We've been using it to test activity with alcohols and certain aspects like that. So the main component of the ECDH is that it's a tetramer containing 4 zinc atoms in each monomeric unit. The role of the zinc atom is to create a coordination with ethanol and the nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide, also known as NAD+. When the ethanol is oxidized to acetaldehyde, and then the NAD gains the ethanol's hydrogen through the hydrogen transfer. As shown here, so we have the ethanol plus ADH plus NAD+ is then oxidized to acetaldehyde and then that, and then the NAD gains this H from the ADH, giving us NADH at 340 nanometers when put in the spectrophotometer. The original studies of the alcohol dehydrogenase began with Neligan and Wolf in 1937. They were the first ones to crystallize and purify the ADH enzyme using a method known as lymphatization techniques. And then was then more refined by Racker in 1949, who discovered the sorbents of the alcohol using the spectrophotometer, and it gave us our assay. The assay is primarily composed of H2O, pyrophosphate buffer, a selection of the enzyme that you want to test. So in our case, we use crude, salted, and then various polymer solutions, and then ethanol, and then we put that into the spectrophotometer, blinked it, and then added NAD+ to it. And then from there, we can record the absorbance of the alcohol of the enzyme's activity, and that gives us our RAC unit. So an example here, we measured it at the 15-second mark, which gave us this number. At the 30-second mark, which gave us that number, we took the 30-second mark number, subtracted from the 15-second mark number, times that by 4,000, which was the average of how many numbers we had, and it gave us our RAC unit, which in this case happened to be 520, and then same with the salted, gave us 240. So then we thought, well, we're using ethanol, why not test it with different various types of alcohol, because we think that at the active site, it should be able to bind to other ones other than ethanol, and so that's what we're testing here. So I went ahead and took the initiative to do salted ADH using this, and then we did the various types of alcohols listed here. But the only one that we really had activity in was the one propanol, but the other ones showed little to no activity. If not, we had negative numbers as well. And that was pretty much that, is that there was just no activity in the other ones, which kind of told us that the ADH can't really bind to other alcohols in this sense.
And so I'm pretty much leading off what he just did. He just did that with salted. I did it with crude. And so I used the same alcohols he used, and same thing. I got the one propanol showing activity the highest, which that gave us, helped us recognize that pretty much the active site is probably only seeing that the front end of that alcohol and then not recognizing the chain. And so we also think that there could be other forms of the enzymes, which is shown up by electrophoresis. And then we found out that there was an activity of the ethanol, of the enzyme without adding any ethanol. And so this was an assay that was done without ethanol, and looks like we have activity here. So it was averaging around like 280, 300 RAF units. And so then again, I went to go test the activity of it and how long it lasted, to see if it was active maybe within 30 minutes or 60 minutes. And it kind of, like I said, it kind of maintains around about 280 on average. I even tested the next morning, midday, and this is all done without ethanol. Okay, now, so then we ran it through a GC, which is a gas chromatography mass spectrometer. And we look, this tells us pretty much what is in any sample that we put in it. We could have put a polymer in it, or else it turned into a big glob. So we just used filtration tubes, and we took out the protein from it, and we stuck it in the GCMS, and they gave us these two peaks here. We believe this peak, this is from our crude sample, so this we believe is the ethanol, and this is just a water peak, and we can see that on the next slide. So water is about an AMU of about 18, so there's that peak representing the water molecule. And then our ethanol has an AMU around 46, so we believe this is ID for that ethanol. And we have more samples. We ran it against an NST library, which shows us a library representation of what ethanol looks like in R's, and they matched up pretty well. And so they gave us a 97% probability that it is ethanol. So we agree that that's what's formed in that GCMS. Looks like now, and then we've got now salted out, so I did that all with crude. So now we did it again with salted out version of that sample, and that peak was absent. So we believe that the salted out took out the ethanol, and there was no identification of that after we ran the GCMS, which is shown there, because there was no peak. There's only the water here.
So we decided to say, since that the process of getting the NADH is done through oxidation, and that's what the OH and the ethanol, we decided to do something different using thiols, which has an SH property, and essentially we're saying, since oxidized is using an O, can we do it with an S? But unfortunately, we only had very little to no activity using the ethane thiols, and this was within the crude, so my guesstimate to why we were getting some activity is because the ethanol that was found within the crude itself, because when we tested it with the salted, there was no activity at all. It just had no activity, didn't run or anything, it's a macro unit. But, and then I did something different where to test this theory out, I only had 100 microliters of the ethane thiol solution, and I got 60 macro units, and then I decided to up it by 100 microliters to see, and I still got the same macro units, so that kind of told me like it's not active at all with the SH group. So we decided to do polymer assays, and essentially what we did, we took a polymer and we did like a 10 to 1 ratio, which we had 1 milliliter of the polymer, which in this case we had PVP, HPC, PA, and PEG, and we added 100 microliters of ADH to it. And in my, I did salted ADH because that was primarily what I was using. And when I did my trials with the polymers, I had no activity at all, as shown here, and I even had negative activity. It told me, is the concentration of the ADH just not great enough, or is the polymer blocking the active sites of the ADH, causing it not to be read on the meter? So I went ahead and adjusted using PEG. I took the salty ADH, adjusted the concentration of it in different like microliters. So I had 1 milliliter PEG to 100 microliters of ADH, 200 microliters of ADH, so on and so forth, all the way up into the 1 microliter of PEG to 1 microliter of ADH. And we saw a significant difference from the beginning of the 100 microliters. And we almost had, when we got to the fourth, we almost had about 4 times the jump in RAC units at the starting point, which is very significant, because it kind of told us that the concentration of the enzyme just wasn't great enough within the polymer solution. So therefore, when we were doing it, the original 10 to 1 ratio, it just wasn't being read. And then we decided to, we were doing electrogelphoresis, and we had to separate the polymer from the enzyme. So I did various different things to try it out. And we took it from Einstein. And this one is called polymer free phase. And The one on the left here is I took the polymer solution, which is a 10 to 4, which is 400 microliters of ADH enzyme, added to 1,000 microliters of the polymer solution, and I put it in here into a separatory funnel, and then I dropped a solid version of ammonium sulfate on top of it to see that if the ammonium sulfate would just draw the enzyme itself, leaving the polymer behind. But unfortunately, I had no activity in it, and it didn't work. But then I went ahead and did it with a saturated version of it, where I put saturated ammonium sulfate on the bottom and dropped the polymer on top and to see if it would coagulate, but it didn't do very much. It just kind of sat there, layers out, and so the study itself just kind of didn't work out for me.
You meant Albertson, by the way.
Sorry, Albertson. And then we bought centrifugal filters, and essentially what we were trying to do was the same thing with the polymer free phase, but instead of putting the solution in ammonium sulfate, we thought we could just spin it down, separating the polymer from the enzyme, diluting it in water, and we got most of the polymer out, but unfortunately the polymer was still in the solution at the top. So when we put it into the top here, and this is the filter, it spins down. We were hoping that all of what we needed would come downwards, leaving us what we needed to test up above in the filter. But the polymer was so thick, it wouldn't spin through the filter. No matter how long we ran it, it was still some in there. And therefore, it kind of messed with the electrophoresis. And then, that's essentially how we collected for the GCMS. We would just put the enzyme in here, the sulfate or the crude. And so the top spun it down and then took whatever the filtrate was. And that's how we discovered that there was ethanol within the crude ADH itself. And that's how we also figured out that the salted ADH is just a purified version with only water.
We ran gel electrophoresis to check for the purity of our ADH after we tested our various purifying methods. To run gel electrophoresis, you need a gel cassette with polyacrylamide gel, and that needs to be placed in a chamber, which will then be placed in an electrophoresis chamber. The inner chamber is filled with cathode buffer, and the outer chamber is filled with anode buffer. But in our case, that buffer turned out to be exactly the same. The gel cassette contained wells, and these wells had to be, we filled these wells with our samples of ADH and loading buffer. Once we ran electrophoresis, the electrical charge would pull on our charged particles and bring them down the gel, and the protein would stop at a certain spot in the gel according to its mass, which we could then read by those separate protein bands that were formed. This is us preparing the first electrophoresis sample. Our initial efforts met with mixed success. We were just getting to know how to properly do electrophoresis. So for our first one, we ran the crude sample of ADH, the salted sample, and we ran a purified version of ADH that we bought. And we got some bands on the crude, less bands on the salted, and purified did not show up at all. This is the standard we use to check the molecular, to check the mass of the sample. These did not come out all that well, since we were just getting to know how to use it. Here we used a different kind of buffer that would not break apart the protein as much, and it turned out to just kind of smear in the gel. Crude showed really heavily because there was a lot. Salted, it was more faint, and again, pure, we could not see anything. We thought maybe it was because we had a very low concentration of pure ADH in our sample.
Yeah. Now, as Brandon was just telling you, we sort of had to find a way to adapt the general electrophoresis techniques that we learned about to our specific use. And before this actual internship, Brandon and I had never performed this, so we were more or less starting from scratch and having to learn both how to do it and how to do it for what we need. So there are two types of gel electrophoresis. There are SDS, which stands for sodium dodecyl sulfate, and there is native polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. Now, the point of native page, or I suppose I should start with SDS page. Now, proteins in their natural state, they are charged, and this is somewhat of a problem if you're trying to separate them with an electrical current, because that natural charge can affect your results and make them spread out not the way you want. If some particular protein is more charged than another, then it won't move the way you want it to if you just want to look at the mass of the actual protein. So when you do SDS page, you use your SDS, you add it to your protein, and that breaks up the tertiary structure of the protein and more or less just scrambles it all into a straight line so that the... And then you also add a reducing agent. In our case, we use beta-mercapta ethanol, which goes through this reaction to break the disulfide bonds that are also in the protein by converting it into a thiol and a diphthyl dialcohol. So the whole point of doing that again is to just make sure that you're just looking at the mass of the protein and not its mass to charge ratio. Because a lot of the proteins in our yeast are very similar in mass to charge, but they can be very different in just mass. So using the SDS page lets us get some much better resolution. And another problem we found was that, as Joseph was describing earlier, one of the processes that we use to extract the protein enzyme, is salting it out of its crude solution. Now, the salt, the little bit that gets left over in the samples, that's a problem because salts are highly ionized particles when in solution. So those particles can grab onto the tertiary and secondary structure of the enzyme and mess with your results and cause the current to pull it to the side or spread out and give very poor resolution as they did in this gel. So we figured out that a way to counter that is to run the salted out sample through a dialysis bag, and that gets out the salt and allows us a much clearer result.
We decided to also run electrophoresis on all our polymer samples with the ADH in them. What we quickly found out was that the polymers, when they run through the gel, they smear completely and give no clear resolution. And when they're dried, they just destroy the gel, which led us to conclude that we really needed to separate the enzyme from the polymer if we were going to perform any electrophoresis on it at all. And Danny here was the lead on trying to separate the polymer from the enzyme.
Oh yeah, so that's what the next couple slides will pretty much answer the question of how to remove the protein from the polymer. Because we know that the protein, ADH, was more attracted to the PEG polymer, but we couldn't run it obviously because it would smear the electrophoresis. So we looked up, we did some research, we read a book by Albertson, and we ended up using it's called the electrophoretic zone sharpening method, and this is the author there. And this is the picture of the book that we referenced. It's pretty much this whole apparatus here. We obviously couldn't make it in time, or buy it in time, or order it, so we designed it ourselves. We came actually in this class in these hoods, and we did some glass making with some Bunsen burners and so forth. And pretty much this is pretty much the mechanics behind it, but this is my little illustration of what I believe is happening. We all know that there's an isoelectric point to the proteins. In our case, the ADH isoelectric point was right here, and that just means that the protein has no charge, it's kind of neutral. So the system pH we were using was this Tris buffer, which was a pH of 7.7. So the pH was then therefore above the isoelectric point in this case, which made that protein a net minus charge here. So ADH has that net minus charge. So we figure, since we have an anode compartment, a cathode compartment, the flow of electrons is going to come from the anode to the cathode, and as it comes in contact with that net minus charge, ADH, it will repel the ADH into a certain part of the apparatus that we had ammonium sulfate in order to salt out and make the ADH precipitate so that we can therefore extract that sample and test it in electrophoresis without polymer. And it actually had good results. And this is just some pictures of John and I both using numerous attempts, I don't know if you can see the broken glass, of designing that apparatus. We used thin glass, thick glass, and we finally constructed a good apparatus. And there's myself doing it. And this is the actual final design of the apparatus here. So we have it in the other lab if you want to take a look at it. It's actually set up just like so. But we had pretty much this running the current. We used different voltages, and so we had our departments there, and so it run through just like that. And this is actually a video of seeing the charge actually in progress. We run through, you can kind of see the ADH flowing through the tube here. You can see that. So this is just, this is when it's on, and the ADH, this is all the crude ADH that's in there, by the way, crude ADH, which gave it that cloudy color. So you can see it being moved or repelled by the electricity that's being run through it. And so yeah, so after we did this, we got my sample and I said, okay guys, do your stuff, run your electrophoresis, and this is the result, and they'll talk to you about that.
So just going through what we ran through this particular gel, this is just the crude enzyme stock taken straight from the yeast. This is salted out after dialysis, and this is crude commercially bought ADH dissolved in water, which the pure ADH was assessed to be 80% pure by its manufacturer, Sigma Aldrich. Now, you can actually see the impurities. In fact, there's this one very significant band right here, and these smaller, lesser bands here and here. And this was an earlier sample taken from the apparatus that Danny designed and dialyzed, because as he was mentioning, the enzyme runs through ammonium sulfate, which again introduces some salt into it, which does mess with the pH. So we have to actually dialyze it in order to get that salt out and get better results. For these two, we didn't have the time to do that, so you notice some slight smearing. However, the smearing is not nearly as significant as it is in these two wells, which is where we attempted to separate the enzyme from the polymers using just centrifugal filters, which did not work at all. So it does in fact prove that the apparatus works for separating enzyme from polymer, and this is the reference based on that we used it. This is the reference gel that tells us the relative molecular weights of everything else in the gel. And one other thing that we weren't quite sure of is this big thick band on the commercially bought ADH, it doesn't correspond to anything on the salted out. And we know that the salted out enzyme is active, it does have activity. So that means one of two things. It means that this commercially bought ADH isn't the same ADH that we were working with in lab, or it means that it's one of these other ADHs that's in it. We really have no way of telling that because this just tells us the molecular weight of the components of the samples. It doesn't tell us what they are.
So everything that you'll see now, I constructed on the program or downloaded from YASARA, which stands for yet another artificial reality application, I believe, or scientific application. But this is ethanol right here. So the two blue balls are carbon, the red would be an oxygen, and the rest, the white, would be the hydrogens bonding. Next, I constructed the actual the ADH. So this is the structure of it. When I run the program, I'll be able to move things, because what good is it if it's just a still image? But you can see the actual zinc right here, and you can see that sulfur. Take note that there's 1, 2, 3 right there. And on the last one, this is the actual structure of
the ADH with the NAD in there, so all the action is right there, and there's some zinc right there, there, and there. And these are the references for all the work that we did and the acknowledgments. And so now I will bring it to the actual program. So this is the interface right here. There's a big learning curve with this. The first thing we'll go ahead and load is if you look, this is what I built. This is the ADH crystal structure, and there's a lot we can do with this. There's different formats I can put it in. I can go all the way from ribbon to just the sticks. There's a lot of different things you can do with it. The things I'll show you in a moment deal with temperature and pressure and density. Just getting to learn how to use this was a lot, but to just simulate what would go on, this is what it would look like. So you can tell that they're moving, they're interacting with each other, and this is just a cell. The dimensions are given by the program, but I actually manipulated them, which I'll show in a second. But if you see, we'll move in right here to the sulfur atom, and you can actually see it vibrating and moving in conjunction with the oxygen right there. It can also analyze anything you want to know. So if you want to know the degrees of freedom that each atom has in respect to each other, do this. And it just did a 6,000 atom computation in less than a second. And if you look down there, it says right there that each individual atom has about 3 degrees of freedom to rotate. So when you're seeing it, it's moving at a min or a max of 3 degrees. So the next one will be the ADH with the NAD. So this thing is massive. And as you can see, again, there is the zinc. The yellow is the phosphorus. But now the next thing is actually getting the ethanol that I showed you earlier to dock to one of the active sites. So with this, it's not straightforward. So we actually had to use code that they made and manipulate it ourselves to actually get it to program. So what I'm going to show you right now is ethanol is going to bound to a single spot on the ADH with the NAD. And it's going to show you, there's two different ways we did this. We use Vena and we use AutoDock. Vena is going to show you within the cubic cell where would be a good place to put the ethanol. But when I show you the AutoDock, it's going to actually show you the best place and the best angle depending upon the amount of energy it costs. So actually seeing is the NAD with the ADH, and this is Vena, and what it's doing is it's actually looking within the cell that I gave it. This I think this is about 5 angstroms, it's actually looking for the best spot. If you see right here, it's running 25 different positions. That was the default. You can add more or less. It's actually telling you the energy that it would cost for it to go to try to dock in one of those specific spots. So this is going to tell us a good spot for it, and this is Vena. Autodock, what I'll show you next, is actually going to give us the best spot with the best angle that it's going to want to dock to it. So right here, if you look, note the differences. This energy right here, 311. Down here, negative 17. This is a big difference. I can add or subtract the dimensions, the XYZ dimensions of the cell to find out if there would be better spots. But the reason I chose these dimensions is because it hits right around the active site, and I don't care if it, we don't care if it's over here. There's no point. Everything we want to know about is right here. So next, I'll show you the auto docking method. So now you can see this is the ethanol again, and this is the active site. And instead of going around the same box, this has the same dimensions. It's in the same area, but the thing is it's not bouncing around. It now knows the perfect position, and it's telling you the perfect angle. It's pretty steady. It's 3.53 kilocalories per mole all the way through. Some are a little less. So the best, again, would be up top, and the worst would be at bottom. But the auto dock was really nice when we figured out how to get it to work, because you don't actually get to tell, it doesn't pick the best spot. We actually had to tell it where to go. But once we figured out how to use this, it told us the best spot, and now it's trying to tell us the best position for it. So that was with ethanol. The last one that I did was with methanol, which was what I ran when I was actually doing the assays, and I got some activity with it, and we're surprised that we got activity with it, because ethanol has the highest, and you don't really want to digest an ethanol. You don't want to put that in your body. So the next one I'll show you is the last one, and it's actually autodock with the methanol. But take note of the binding energy and the disassociation constant with ethanol in comparison to the methanol. So now if you take a look at the difference, it's one less, which doesn't seem like a lot, but if you're from being able to tell back and forth, this one's actually moved back a lot further, pushing everything here else closer together. A lot of this, most of this was done within a week of learning this, and it wasn't a straightforward program as we had hoped. A lot of the stuff you're seeing was like time and time. The computers crashed a lot. There's a lot of computation with it. Learning how to use it up here, there's so many variations of things you can do with the simulations. You can put force fields on it. You can get the electrostatic potential, pressure, density, the radius, the energy. There's just so much you can do with this. And getting knowing what you want to do and actually getting it to work are two different things. We had to do a lot of the research on our own to find out how this worked. But this leads a lot of opportunity now, knowing how it works, to do things. When you have a program like this, that once you know how to use it, it really leads the research that you can do in the future, or the potential theory of what you can do once you know how to do it. So this concludes the USARA aspects. Anybody else want to say anything? All right, thank you.
Questions from anybody?
I could ask a question.
Go for it.
So when you were showing like the gel electrophoresis that you had run, and you were saying that the pure ADH sample that you purchased wasn't showing up when you were running it, how did you address that? Did you increase the concentration and it worked?
Yeah.
Okay. I missed that part.
We originally put the ADH in buffer and then took a little bit out of there and tried to put it in. That's when it didn't work. So the manual actually says to take the actual powder and just stick it straight in.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, with just a little bit of the blue stuff.
Okay.
And that's how it worked great.
Yeah, because one of the things was that when we were using the pure alcohol dehydrogenase for testing activity, if you use too much, then you can't even test. It exceeds the ability of the spectrophotometer to measure it. So we were working with a lower concentration than we need for the electrophoresis. So we kind of had to adapt it and use a higher concentration.
Yeah.
So which one was the...
Yeah. This
one
here.
You bought in this one?
See, here's the purified sample that we purchased and we paid good money for, right? And the intensity of the band is proportional to concentration. So the higher intensity of band is the one that's most concentrated. It doesn't tell you what it is. It's just a relative concentration. So when you look here, you say, well, we purchased a purified enzyme that was 80% purified. This has to be it. But we don't have that band here in our salted out. We see a small band in our crude, nothing down here, nothing down here. So you see very consistent bands here and here, and those are consistent all across the floor. So it could be that Sigma mislabeled it. I don't think so. It could be that we're not dealing with the enzyme that we thought we were dealing with, probably more likely. And we're dealing with not one of the band that we thought, but we're dealing probably more with one of the adjacent bands. There's several different types of enzymes in our crude. And one of the things that we're going to have to address next year is how can we purify this, number one, and Daniel took a huge step with his apparatus, and how can we identify them? How do we know which one is which? Is there an enzyme in there that's very primitive from a long time ago that's actually capable of oxidizing methanol? We haven't used it for 100,000 years, but is it there? The docking program can lead to some of that. If it all sends it to the same location and the energy is pretty much the same, maybe it is. Maybe the active site is just a hole that recognizes only the terminal carbon with the OH on it. And it doesn't matter if that's a 4-carbon chain, 5-carbon chain, as long as it's on the terminal OH. And the data suggests that. We had activity with 1-butanol, 1-propanol, ethanol, and methanol. But we didn't have activity with isopropyl, which doesn't have has that OH on the end to the carbon. So these are, as research always does, it leads to more questions than answers. So we're pretty well prepared for next year, especially with our returning geniuses with electrophoresis. These guys really, really fixed it up for us because we weren't really experts in that. That's what we're about. But yeah, it appears we did purchase some purified enzyme.
If I might make a comment and ask questions, very impressive work, gentlemen. It seems like you've learned a lot, advanced the experimental capabilities of your research team. That's always an important thing to do. One question I like to ask is and people will recognize this question from this morning, is when you talk to your colleagues, your relatives, your family, whatever, and tell them what you're doing with your research, what do you say? How do you explain to them, assuming that they're not chemists or anything like that? What do you say? How do you explain it?
They relate everything I do to Breaking Bad. They just say, oh, so you're another icebreaker. I say something like that. Yeah, something like that.
Just like that without the money, right?
Yeah. True.
Brandon?
They have no background in this, so it's very hard to explain. Yeah. So
how I can tell them is that we're working with an enzyme that just that sort of purifies alcohol from our body, and that's really all we can tell them, because anything else would be almost too much.
Okay.
And I'm in much the same boat, and a lot of it too is I've only taken one semester of general chemistry, so a lot of the stuff I don't understand, so I can't really explain it, but at least with the gel electrophoresis, I usually just say, okay, I'm looking at how pure it is against, how pure our extraction and refinement process is against known standards, like the commercially bought and the salted out, ones that we know work. And I just sort of, I guess that's just how I explain it.
Fortunately for me, my family comes from a scientific background, so a lot of the stuff that I say to them, they kind of understand, but I do get those like general questions like, okay, like what's ADH or like what's crude? And so I just kind of break it down from there, but I do have that fortunate in my life that my family just come from a scientific background.
I just tell them I'm going to make a volcano that's going to explode today. Like a science fair one. It's all my mixed chemicals, and I don't really get into the details of it, and I tell them I sit behind a computer and do the same thing and recreate it. So just try to explain it as best you can without being too detailed, but not really specific, but enough to where they understand what I do. So.
You guys have any suggestions for next year?
Always wear goggles when you're making, when you're working in class.
Yeah, we know that.
Well, something that I kind of thought of when during the second week when we were doing this was one of the big things that Professor Kennedy was wanting us to test was the ethane thiol, where it's ethanol except the oxygen is replaced with the sulfur. And something that I got mildly curious about is, what if it's ethanol except the alpha carbon is replaced with the silicon, which is just below carbon on the periodic table, so maybe it would have a bunch of similar properties and it might even get some activity going on where it actually does reduce the NAD. The problem is that we couldn't find anyone that commercially sells it, and no one here is really experienced with inorganic synthesis, and a lot of the reagents are also highly explosive. But
let's do it.
Yeah.
Yeah, sounds like fun.
I mean, I would be really interested in trying it if some avenue could be found to look into that.
I think one cool thing to try next year is, because we were saying that there's 7 different types of the ADH enzyme that we could possibly use, seeing if we can use a different level of the enzyme and see if we can match it to the pure that we do have that we did buy to see if we get similar bands like that. Because maybe we are just using a different type of the enzyme.
Next year, hopefully, all the progress is done in the last week, I learned. So the first 2 weeks are the learning curve, and then everything gets done the last week. But learn how to use the program ahead of time. We took we kind of went out on a whim with this, and we looked at a lot of other ones, but this is the one that worked best. You can make a lot of money if you can code for them, so I found that out. The times it crashed, they'll give you money if you tell them why it crashed in C. And the more experience you have in chemistry, the easier this is. A lot of this stuff I did in general or organic, and they did it better than me. So you can do anything you put your mind to.
All right, good job, guys. Very good job.